let me tell you something. You know, a friend of mine called me and says, KSM, when is your rematch with Kwame Sechiama? And I said, oh, what are you talking about? He said, oh, I heard you on Kwame Sechiama's show. And you said you had a rematch. I said, ah, me. Me call Kwame Sechiama, who is Kwame Sechiama? I said, ah, KSM. So you don't know Lexis Bill? I said, you don't know. So for the first time, I found out that one of the great voices I love so much is called Kwame Sechiama. Put your hands together. Show some love for Lexis Bill. Yes, sir. Kwame.
Wafa.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you very
much. We're going to just post the calls when we come back.
Definitely.
It's a rematch. We'll be right back. Stick around, folks. We'll be right back.
It's going to get sweeter than guinea fowl. It's the KSM Show.
Lexis Bill. It's funny, you know, sometimes you see, you know people by the names that you know them by.
Yeah,
you
know.
And the guys are, that's why when they come in, Murray Machina, when I'm saying, Kwame Bay.
Kwame Bay. I mean, I get that a lot. Seeing as Lexis has, it's the name that everybody
exactly,
knows.
Exactly.
I think about 3 or 4 years ago, I tried to, you know, tone it down.
Okay.
So I went on air and I'm like, okay, guys, I want you guys to call me by my real name,
mm-hmm.
Kwame Sechiama.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, from there, you guys should tone on Lexis.
Yeah,
I've been Lexis for a while, but please,
yeah.
I want you to call me by Kwame Sechiama. I open phone line, somebody calls, oh, Lexis! So, yeah.
Lexis Bill has swag on, you know, that's some swag.
Oh, that's it?
Lexis Bill, man.
One of those nicknames that didn't go away, so we're stuck with it.
But you've been doing radio for a while, man.
Yeah.
It's like you are Mr. Radio.
Bumped into it 2004, so
okay.
It's been that long.
Was your first bump at the UST or before tech you were?
No, that was actually UST. Before tech, I just was a lover of radio like everybody else.
Okay.
I mean, I didn't even think that it was a profession I could do or I
mm-hmm.
could get into.
Mm-hmm.
So, but real radio experience, you know, getting into it to know that, okay, this is how this thing works, was 2004 at KNUST.
At KNUST.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
What program were you doing there? Was it a regular...
So I got on, I tell you, my first radio experience, though, was me going on as a resource person to talk about love. Can you believe that?
About love? I can't believe it, man.
And that is why at this stage, I say thank you very much to Google. Because thanks to Google,
you learned all about love.
I learned all about love. I didn't know anything about it. But I went on there, spoke confidently about it, and they're like, wow, what a resource person. He knows it all.
He knows it all, man.
I didn't even have a girlfriend.
I tell you
the story exactly. So I was invited. So this gentleman at the radio station who hosts the program says, I want you to come and talk about love. So that night, I went to an internet cafe.
Mm.
I mean, then my phone didn't have any internet.
Mm-hmm.
Went to an internet cafe, went to print lectures on love.
On love.
So we come do the show, and the next day, I have to go for class. And, you know, because I wasn't, and it was a new class, so we didn't know each other by names, actually.
Mm.
I sat behind two ladies who were like, oh, did you listen to the resource person Focus FM brought yesterday? And they were talking about how the guy was talking about love, and there'll be a repeat, and all of that. I say, hey. And they said, yeah, man. I mean, they were talking about me in the class, and I was there, and I couldn't even tell them that, oh, I was
you.
The one, because I'm sure they'd be like, oh, please. Yeah, so basically that's how it started.
You continue being a resource person for love, or you?
No, I gave up. It was too difficult. I didn't understand most of the things I was talking about, honestly. I was just reciting what I learned.
Mm-hmm.
But the gentleman who hosted the show happened to be the program's manager, and he says, I like the way you talk. I think you should try radio.
Mm.
You should do it.
Mm.
So he puts me on the morning show guy's show to listen, to watch, to do what he does and all. I studied for a couple of days, and luckily, the gentleman was also a student, so he had a mid-semester one morning. Nobody to do the show. They're like, ah, you've been here for a few days. You should be able to find your way around. I'm like, okay, put me there.
I'll do it.
And they put me in there, and that was it.
Wow.
Yeah.
And as I say, the rest is history. So you've been in radio since?
Yes, since then.
Well, you wanted to, your dad wanted you to be a doctor, go and study medicine, and also be a radio. You know, how did that go?
You know, I tell you, it wasn't like I had a choice. Okay. I didn't have a choice. I had to be a doctor. He came to Accra because of me, to bring me to Presec so I go and study science.
So you'll be a doctor?
So I'll be a doctor. Unfortunately or fortunately, you know how you're picking schools and subjects and they're like, you know, if you don't get this aggregate, they won't give you the course.
Mm.
So I think that particular semester, that particular term in JSS, my maths wasn't good.
Mm.
So my teacher is like, told my mom, look, if he takes science and he doesn't get the 6, he wouldn't be given in Presec. And my dad says, look, Presec or nowhere else.
Wow.
So I had to choose general arts. And even that, I buy a cranmer blue. Eight. Was it ones or ace? One of them.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. Ones. Yeah. So I actually had a pass mark, but already chosen general arts. So I knew that the course to be a doctor had, you know, been a little diverted. But basically, that's what my dad wanted me to do. I didn't want to be a radio presenter. It wasn't like it was a mission. Oh, dad wants you to do medicine and you want to be a radio presenter. No, it never even came up.
Okay.
I never even thought of how I could. You know how you're watching TV and you're wondering, those days when I was watching, I was wondering how you were in the TV. You know. So I didn't really know how it worked and what it took to be there until somebody prompted me and said, look, I think the way you talk and you speak, you could do radio.
Really?
And I took it up, yes.
Wow. Who am I? It was really picked it.
Alexander Asante, yes. He's still around. He does publishing now, but he's an amazing person. He spots talents from afar, you know, and he was able to predict and say, look, I think you'll be a great radio presenter. And he was one of those people who give you the opportunity and say, okay, I need you to do this, I need you to do that, learn this, learn that, and it will help you.
Hmm.
Yeah.
How did you move to Accra? How did that move come about?
Well, to be honest, I didn't want to come to Accra. And that's because when I went to Kumasi, I never lived in Kumasi. But when I went to school, I was scanning the radio, and it was really not the kind of radio I wanted to listen to. So when I got the opportunity to do the kind of radio I wanted and the kind of radio that we don't do, so we set up a radio station called Radio Ecstasy together with Andy Kem and a few other people. And they had the vision to do an urban radio, a youth urban radio. And I got to serve on it as a presenter and as a programs manager.
Mm.
And so I got the opportunity to put my ideas out there and the things that I would love to hear on radio out there. So it was a personal passion that I wanted to develop and help build in Kumasi.
Mm.
And it caught on so well. I mean, the student folks in Kumasi needed that kind of youth urban radio. The young executives and business executives alike also wanted something urban to listen to. So it was that alternative for them. So I really didn't want to come to Accra because many times people will come and say, you are doing all this and you should be in Accra, you should be in Accra. And I'm like, what is it in Accra? You know? But I didn't know what I was missing. until I had a conversation with Woody Kwache, who then suggested that I should spend time with them. And it was just a vacation. I came down after a little break from there, joined Hits FM for a little bit. And I was like, okay. It's nice here. And I think my mom and my dad had missed me. They're like, where were you school? What are you But so yeah, basically I took that offer, spoke to them. It was just a weekend thing I was doing, but gradually there were other opportunities. I got to do the morning show as well, and I got to stay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But you were with Hits.
Hits FM, yes.
And then they moved you to
Joy FM.
To Joy?
Yes. So from Hits FM doing the morning show, I started doing the late night access on Joy FM. Then Hits FM had decided to do a lot more local flavor, more like that wasn't how, you know,
yeah.
I was more urban, you know. So yeah. I decided, they gave me the late night express. I said, why not? Mm-hmm. Don't mind. Mm-hmm. I'll do it.
And the move to Drive Time, that's strong, you know, Drive Time. Drive Time is it, man.
It is. Yeah. I mean, arguably the biggest late afternoon radio show in Ghana. So it is an honor, actually.
How was the approach? When were you told that we are considering you to?
When I moved to Joy FM, aside doing the late night express, along the line, I had to do the multi-track show after Jamie passed. May his soul rest in peace. So I was doing After the Drive, which ended at 8 o'clock. I was on air from 8 till midnight. Now, when Bola, who was doing the drive time then, wasn't around, I would sit in for him as well.
Mm.
So I was actually on the drive a few times. When he's not around, I'll do it and stuff. So there was this one time, and when he goes on leave. So he went on leave one fateful June or thereabouts, and they're like, okay, you need to start because Bill is going on leave. I'm like, okay, fine. Regular thing for me to do. So I start doing the show after a week or two, then rumors start going around that, oh, he's resigning. I'm like, okay. You know? So I'm just doing the show, and then the conversation is now going around. Okay, he's no more. It was confirmed that he wasn't going to be in with Joy FM again. And I was just sitting in my place, just doing the show. And so then they said, okay, well, since he's not there, you'd have to do the show. I'm like, okay, I'll do it.
How did it feel, man?
It was exciting. Yeah. You know, it was it was good. It was because this is actually the biggest show. And Bolloré had done it for 13 years or so. You know, had done everything with the show. You know,
big shoes
had
to
taken
fill.
It to all the heights that it's been, it's seen. All the top people had been on the show. So you had to either do it well, as equally as he does it, or do it better. So it was a big challenge thrown at you. But for me, it didn't come as a challenge. Okay. It just came as what you are supposed to do.
Yeah. Just keep doing it.
Just do what you're supposed to do. So I just took it and did what I was supposed to do. I had how I run my show. I do my show the way I do it. So it was just the same thing that I needed to, the same approach I needed for that show. And I went along with it.
Hey, it's a lot, man. And you had some pretty good guests too, man.
Oh, yes. Including KSM. You know him?
That's why there's this rematch, man.
Yes, I've had amazing people on it. One of my memorable ones would be the former vice, the former first lady. She was on a few weeks ago. Had a good time with her.
You danced with her?
Had a viral video.
Yes.
Please don't show that video. I have a feeling you're
about to. Let's take a pause right now. Since he asked me not to show it, please. Let's take a quick minute. Take a look at this. Wow, so there you have it, man. The legs is getting the whole
first. Oh, my goodness,
she's got moves too.
Oh, she's got moves for days. I mean, in my family, I'm the best dancer, but look, that one is wet. I mean, she just but yeah, it was good. Yeah. I've had a lot of very prominent people on as well, international guests and all, members of parliament and business leaders alike, and it's been good.
Yeah,
I say glory to God.
It's great. It's great. I mean, you know, like you said, Bola took it like, you know, so you filled the shoes and you have done extremely well.
Thank you very much.
You've done extremely well.
I think one of the important things that I got was the fact that the team supported me. The team were like, look, you got us. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I need to say kudos to the team at Joy FM, my producers. They were like, look, let's do this. You know, because there was a lot of chatter around the period, you know, because it's Bola, hello. You've got to be up and doing, you know. And a lot of people will say, oh, no, he can't. Oh, no, he can't. But I need to say glory to God. We're actually in our third year now. And by God's grace, we won the radio program of the year, the CIMG Awards. Last year. So I just believe that God has been good to us.
And you believe you're kicking ass too.
Oh yeah. I you know that done well thing? You know what they say?
If it must be done well.
Be done well. Yeah. That thing keeps ringing at the back of my mind. Give it your best or nothing at all. Taste not or drink deep.
Or drink. I like that. And they can't laugh.
Yeah.
That One question you asked me that I'm going to ask you too, because this is a rematch. Are you romantic? Hello, Mr. Samuel. You are quite the same. You know, you're romantic. No, but you look romantic. You were doing a show on love.
Oh, they are romantic looks.
Yeah, they are romantic looks, man.
I think I am not romantic.
Really?
Yes. I think I am not.
Who's to say you're not? Was it? Did you hear this from? Was it? Who said you are not romantic? So obviously, it must be a recipient of your romance who can make that judgment.
I think this is the part you have. You have a. You know what I mean? Because this question now is that how you felt when I asked the question? It has thrown me off a little bit. You know, I don't know whether I am or not. I believe in every relationship, you just need to do what is right for the moment and go the extra mile. Probably that is what we would call as being romantic. So a few times, yes, I've gone the extra mile, but I don't know whether it's even enough to say, oh, you're romantic. Like, because I really haven't heard anybody say, oh, Lexis, you're romantic. You know what I mean? So probably maybe that's why I'm saying I'm not romantic, because maybe...
But who's the recipient? Now that we're on the subject of romantic, being romantic, who's the recipient of your...
Oh, my fiance.
Yeah.
She's not told me I'm romantic.
She hasn't told you?
No. Never said that. And now I'm feeling bad. Like, have I failed?
I think it would be nice to invite the both of you here.
Sometime, yes.
Yeah, sometime, you know.
No, wait, let me make it official first.
Okay.
When I make it official, I'll just bag it here.
How close are we to officialdom?
Oh, soon.
Soon?
Soon.
Really?
I don't think there's anything left to do.
Wow. How long have you been going out there?
Two, going on three.
Oh, beautiful.
So, I don't see any stumbling block. It's just probably preparations and, you know,
and what does
settling
she do?
Down. She's in insurance. So.
She's in insurance?
Yeah.
Done well?
No.
I don't know.
That's a good one. Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's cool. That's cool. And so outside of, you know, you love what you're doing. You love radio so much. And well, probably everyone said that when you do something you love, it doesn't feel like work.
Totally.
You know, and enjoy it and you get paid for that too.
Yes, hey, I totally
can't
agree.
Can't complain.
I mean, there were a few times I look at myself and I'd be like, I'm having fun with this.
Am I working?
Getting paid, you know? You know, but I say now that the radio as I saw it before, or, you know, after a few years of getting into it, it's different. You know, it is not just what we sit in the studio and do. When you create a public front, you are supposed to use that public front to interact with people. And now I'm very convinced that that's actually even a harder job than what we do in the studio. Because only in the studio, we have fun. I mean, you hear, interview people, have fun. But when you step out there, that is a bigger job. Because somebody even just sees you and wants to tell you what they're going through. And they actually assume that you've got to have the right things to tell them. You know, so constantly you have to be updated. Constantly you have to be able to... it's more like sacrificing yourself for other people. Luckily for me as well, I started Hits FM with a relationship morning show. So you'd have a lot of people telling you very private things they regularly wouldn't tell their friends or family members or whatever it is. And they expect you to be able to find the right things to tell them. I mean, I've met people who are actually at the point of suicide. I've had to actually talk to somebody who is on the phone with a bottle of DDT and says, look, you're the one I want to speak to before I do this. And I've had to find something to tell them to put that thing down and reconsider life again. You know, so constantly, these are the things you're confronted with. So just maybe God put some of us where we are to be able to touch others'
lives
to share what we have. So to share a bit of joy with somebody.
I like it. So it's more than radio.
It's more than radio. It's totally more than radio. It's totally more than radio. And I'm sure a lot of public figures also get that. In my position, you'd have to use it to affect a life, to influence people, to create happiness everywhere you go.
Fantastic, fantastic. And you do own a gym.
Yes, I do.
Wow.
I do.
I was very... Well, I am very proud of you. When I heard the man owns a gym, I'm like, hey, wow.
Thank
you. Been into fitness?
Not exactly.
Okay.
So it was just born out of a wake-up call, a realization. I think about 7-8 years ago, I kept hearing my friends passing. You know,
as young as you are,
35 and they're dead, 40 and they're dead. And the cause was the problem. You hear, you know, when much younger, you see what, esikafoyare,
diabetes,
hypertension, BP.
Yeah.
You could hear that these are for rich old people who have their. But a 35-year-old brother dies of diabetes, dies of hypertension. So I started getting worried because almost every week there's a funeral I have to be to of a colleague or somebody who is around my age.
Yeah.
So I got worried and I started speaking to a few of the doctors and I said, look, what is going on? And they educated me and let me know that, look, there's a new wave. I mean, where our lifestyles are sedentary. Everybody is stuck behind their desk all day.
Yeah.
We don't have a regular exercise regime. We're eating all the wrong things. Mm-hmm. Back in the day, ye chi abomno, ye chi nyadwa, ntroa, any abedri. I mean, I don't remember the last time I saw abedri. Very organic food. But now we're stuck to all these quick food stuff because we don't have time. We have to make money. You have to live. You have to get busy. So I was worried. And then I started, you know, thinking. So my doctor asked me, so do you get tired after taking, you know, the stairs and all? I was like, I pant. Okay, so start exercising. So the first time I went jogging up a hill, and here's me after like 150 meters panting. And this old lady is just
strutting along.
Strutting along, going, and I'm looking back like, what just happened? Like, you know, I was a young man. Why am I suffering? Why am I panting? So I knew that the only way out is exercise and good diet. So I started exercising, and then I realized that, okay, I'm getting better at this. I don't get as tired as I do at the end of the day and all of that. I'm not as lazy as I was. I'm more active and I feel better. And that was it. And I got into it. So I started you know, propagating the word. I used to live in Ashalibochu, and in the evening, when I used to do the morning show, around 3 or 4 o'clock, you see me jogging, going to the gym. I used to jog to the gym that I used to work out at. And people would see me, I like it, what's up? Just so people would get to know that, okay, there probably is something in exercise. And so I discovered it and I decided to perpetuate, you know, spread the word. Yeah.
Fantastic. Show some love, man. But that's great. That's great. And it's amazing service that you're doing, you know, because you're right, you know.
Yeah.
Get up, sit in your car, drive to the office,
get out of the office,
air condition to air condition.
Straight.
Go
and
home,
that's it.
Eat, sleep.
And that is the routine for so many young folks, so many young business folks. And anytime I speak to them, they're like, oh, I don't have the time.
Yeah.
I'm like, look, if you drop dead, your boss is going to find somebody to sit in your chair.
Right away,
that minute.
Yeah.
Nothing else matters. And I always say that I invest in exercise. That nothing else matters. You know what I mean?
Everything
so as much as possible, once you're alive, you'd want to do everything to enjoy the moment and feel all right. And so the setting up of the gym wasn't born even out of business. It was totally born out of passion. You know, and
a good cause.
To get
show him some love, man. Show him some love, man. No. It's amazing. And I'm glad you're doing it.
We actually took it beyond just the gym as well. And that's how come we started work with Lexis and decided to get a lot more people, you know, conscientized about exercise and the benefits of exercise. And so many people have, you know, gotten on it. They have started living the exercise life. Now, if you go up the Bri Mountain, there's a whole festival,
know.
But when we started, it wasn't like that. And that was because we wanted people to, you know, get into it. And the only way they can do it is if they know that it's a social interaction platform as well. It's not just the exercise. So people just walk up the mountain and back and don't even remember that they are there to exercise.
Yeah.
Because they're having fun.
Yeah.
But they're doing some physical activity. Mm-hmm. So as much as possible, a lot of work needs to be done to get a lot more people out there. So I just think that a lot more people should be encouraged.
No, I'm glad you're raising this voice because it's true. This is a lifestyle that's killing us.
Yeah.
You know, and if like you're talking about, if you hear that obituary numbers are now reduced, we used to joke about when you get like 60, 70 and above, you know, then you are in the departure lounge, you know, you're waiting for the your flight arrival.
You know,
this departure lodge.
All those with protocol and whatever diplomatic passports, we need to bring you back. So we can all, you know, enjoy our lives the best way we can.
Fantastic. Lexis, man. It's DJ Honey, our man.
Yes.
So good to have you here.
Thank you so
man.
Much. Thank you. I've enjoyed
it. It's great.
You know why I'm in white? I'm on your show. And outdoor radio. I'm on KSM show.
Share so long one more time.
You're doing great
with exercise thing. God bless you.
Thank you.
And all the best, man. It's
thank
great
you.
Having you here.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'm glad.
Folks, stick around. Kwame Sechiama, be from the Lexis Bill.
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
If you reach for that remote, I will bite you. The KSM show will be right back.